So we'll get into the actual methodology now and what the running lean process is about. So one thing that I like to very quickly point out is that there is for any methodology, there are principles and there are tactics, and it's important to separate the two. So principles tell you the general ideas, and tactics tell you how to do things. So principles tell you, why you're doing things, how the framework works, and tactics are more of the how of how you do it. And so we'll look at many examples here. And so what I'm going to cover here are the three meta principles that guide running lean. And throughout the afternoon, we'll go down and talk about specific tactics of how do you actually implement those specific principles. And so these are the three principles that we'll walk through. And so the first one is documenting your plan A. So I mentioned early on how the job of a startup is to go from that initial plan to one that works before running out of resources. But before you can actually get there, you have to write down what it is that you're trying to achieve. You have to write down that plan A. And the reason that's important is because of this, is that as entrepreneurs, we are especially gifted at building these reality distortion fields in our heads, and we can rationalize anything. And so if you don't write this stuff down and are very clear and explicit about it, you can always be making progress, and you can always convince yourself that you're on the right track. So it's very important to write that stuff down. And even more important, to share it with one other person. So writing it down for yourself is a great exercise, but once you have that accountability with even a co-founder or an advisor or an investor, all of a sudden you're drawing lines in sand. You're actually putting a stake in the ground and holding yourself accountable to what you think will happen and what actually does happen, which is a great reality check to impose upon yourself if you're interested in following this process, if you're interested in raising those odds of success. Because otherwise it's the fastest way to really iterate is in your head. I would say a whiteboard is fast, but your head is even faster because you can change your mind every day. You can be going in 10 different directions every day. But as we'll see, that's just a recipe for going around in circles and not really making a lot of headway. So typically a business plan has been used for that purpose. That's kind of been the job of the business plan. So how many folks here have ever written a business plan before? And so keep your hands up if you enjoy that process. So it's a few hands shaking, but some people do enjoy it, and that's actually a good exercise. The problem is it's only a good exercise for the entrepreneur. And I don't have a problem with business plans particularly because it does make the entrepreneurs sit down and write this document about what it is they're trying to achieve. So it is fundamentally meeting the goal I was talking about, and that is documenting your hypotheses, documenting what you think will happen. The problem is that it kind of takes it too far. So people are asked to do 3 to 5 year projections, things like that, which become more exercises in fiction than in actual fact. And so when you have to do those kinds of things, you end up spending a lot of energy filling in gaps and really and almost writing a fictional document than one that's based on fact. And so for those reasons, I actually prefer to do a much more lightweight version of the business plan, which is just focusing on the business model. And I know a lot of you have seen what I'm going to show next, but this is a one-page document that captures the essential elements of your business plan on a single page. And so some of the benefits that you get out of that is that, one, it's very fast to do one of these. Rather than taking several weeks or months to write a 60-page business plan document, do all the research, get all the numbers, do all the fancy graphs and graphics, you can do this thing in an afternoon. You can do several of these in an afternoon. And so it's a great brainstorming tool, and we'll walk through the process of doing that. The second thing is it's very concise. I find it much harder to explain an idea succinctly than write paragraphs and pages about something. And especially when you're doing a startup, you have to very quickly communicate the essence of what you're doing to advisors, to investors, even to your customers. I mean, customers these days are bombarded with all kinds of marketing messages, and so when they hit your landing page, you have to clearly be able to give them a message that resonates with them. So this is a great exercise for that. We have blocks like unique value proposition, which are exercises for practicing that constraint right on the canvas itself. And then lastly, I like it because it's very portable. It's very easy to share with someone. I can put it in front of somebody on my iPad or just a sheet of paper in front of someone, and they can't help but not read it. So it's not like an executive summary is a shorter version of a business plan, but even that sometimes doesn't get read. But one of these things, I can go into a coffee shop, have a meeting with an advisor or investor, show them what I'm working on, and they can't help but not read it. And more importantly, they can't help but not have opinions about it. And that's what we're really looking for, is starting that conversation. So I do find this to be a very effective tool for creating that feedback loop with those kinds of people. So that's particularly why I like this format. So so this particular format is called Lean Canvas, and it is rooted in a more original version called the Business Model Canvas, which was developed by Alex Osterwalder. It's actually his PhD thesis, so I like to show his version here because many people ask me afterwards, you know, what's the difference between the two? And so I did start with this version, but what I found is that some of the blocks on there ended up, for my cases, being a little too general. Like, this seemed to be a very good way of documenting business plans that were already working. I was more interested in how do I go from an idea and get to that product market fit stage, and even somewhat beyond. I do think the Lean Canvas goes beyond that. But I found it, and I was also practicing a lot of the Lean Startup concepts, so I wanted to find more actionable things that I could put on the canvas that would increase the signal-to-noise ratio. So replacing things like key partners, which, as I'll talk about, are very important, but I don't think they're your day one problems. I mean, your day one problem is your problem. So I replaced that with the problem box, and then also being very explicit about things like solution and key metrics were more important to me. And so I made some adaptations there, and that's how Lean Canvas came about. But you know, you're more than welcome to look at the original version and pick whichever one. The bigger goal that I have is encouraging you to actually, you know, write down these hypotheses on a format that works for you. So we're going to spend a lot of time going into the details of the canvas. I'm not going to go into explicit boxes right now. But the one key takeaway that I will want to leave with you for now is realizing that the solution is not really the product that you think, it's not really the product of your startup. So as entrepreneurs, we are most passionate about the solution box. That's really what excites us. We want to build the best possible solution. And if you look at this, Dave McClure is an investor, 500 startups, and he has heard many entrepreneurs pitch. And in one of those pitches, he made an observation and actually came out and told people to stop doing what they were doing, and that is talking. So in a typical five-minute startup pitch, entrepreneurs were spending 3 to 5 minutes just talking about their solution. They would kind of do a cursory glance over the other 8 boxes on the canvas, talk about the problem, the market, but then spend a lot of time just talking about how great their solution was, because that's what entrepreneurs are really in love with. But that's not really the product that we're building. What we're really building is the entire business model, and the business model does become a product. And for me, that was, it's a very simple concept, but it was very empowering. And as we'll see, a lot of what we talk about here kind of derives from that kind of epiphany of business model being a real product that we're building. So before that, I would look at the business model as really something I would have to make work eventually, or something I would have to do to get my company funded if I wanted to do that. But otherwise, I was just going to build stuff and see if it works, and otherwise just, you know, keep working on what I was doing. So I was only iterating on the solution and not really that concerned about the other things. They would fall in place magically. That's what I was hoping for. But looking at this as a complete problem makes these 8 boxes become a jigsaw puzzle that we now have to put together, and it becomes the entrepreneur's job to put it together. And that's something that I stress very, very heavily, is that it's not going to magically come together. You have to actively work on it from day one. And that's why starting with that initial canvas is a great exercise. And that metaphor of thinking of your business model as a product is one that you will also see reflected in the meta principles that I talk about. So if you look at how we build complicated products, if you have a complicated product or problem to solve, there's a divide and conquer principle, which is we take this big problem and break it up into chunks, and we tackle them in chunks or in smaller manageable pieces. If you look at what the canvas does, it actually does exactly that. It takes a very complicated problem of building a startup or building a product that actually succeeds, breaking it up into these 9 specific boxes, which are smaller problems we can then systematically tackle.